From the heights of Cucamonga Peak and the depths of Alta Loma, it's Live on the Couch with Dr. Strange.
That was semi-acceptable. We'll fix that in editing. Hi, everybody. Look, it's me again. I know you don't want to see me. It is Super Strange Fun Day. Screw the Super Bowl, except for the Puppy Bowl, which I'm a fan of. Is this thing on? Can you hear me? Okay, guys. Thank you all. I know you're all big sports fans. You're all going to get a good play. For hanging out here. I appreciate you coming in. I say it every time, but the truth is, it's 100% true. I'm so happy and honored to have bands and guests come in here. So today is kind of different in a lot of ways. It's a band, legendary people. We got a book to promote. So let's get started. Right? All right. I'll leave my microphone over here. Okay, these people need no introduction, but I will introduce them. Gitane and Rikk Agnew. Nico, the book editor, he's a little weird. He couldn't be here right now, but he kind of is. I have a X name.
Right here, right here.
This is in celebration of Roz Williams. It's a book that Nico has repressed, From Christian Death to Death, and we have some legendary people here in my mind, and they really are. They have worked with Roz and many other things. I'll show you a quick little flip through the book. It is available online. It's very cool.
Has it's absolutely all of essential for anyone who's interested in Roz Williams or Christian Death
or Roger Friedman.
It has all of Roz's bands, lyrics, artwork. It's really poetry. Something special. Poetry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was really, truly a poet.
So. Well, let's go ahead and start off with that. What's your first introduction to Roz? I mean, when did you meet him?
I met him at a show at SIR Studio in Hollywood. TSOL, Christian Death, a band I was in called Pompeii 99, mm-hmm. and some other bands. I can't remember who they were. Do you remember that show? Because you were playing. And I saw Christian Death playing there. I'd seen them at other shows.
What year?
But this was 1982, maybe. Mm-hmm. And after that show, I met Roz.
And you hit it off? Or?
No, I was really shy, and he was somewhere else. He was like in his own little world. He had a friend with him. He usually had an escort with him that would take him around to the bathroom or wherever. And he was in very quiet mode. I'm generally pretty quiet as well. So I just met him. And then a few years later, then I was in his band.
That's one thing I want people to realize too. That really was Roz. He didn't wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to be this weirdo or this different person. That's who he was every single day of his life, right? I mean, that was who he was.
Well, he didn't wake up in the morning for one thing anyway. He usually went to bed in the morning and he would get up in the afternoon like most musicians that I know, except for us in our mature years. But he would get up, but he was not necessarily a quiet person. He was hilarious. He was one of the funniest people I ever met. Get a few drinks in him and he would hold court in his living room and you would just be laughing, crying.
Really?
He was really very, very articulate, hilarious. People think that he was in his own little, crumbling world. But I mean, sure, don't we all have those quiet moments and sad moments? But he was hilarious. He was a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun. He was the godfather of my son also. And so we spent a lot of time together when I moved back from Europe.
So, if you would say he's more like an upbeat or was more of an upbeat person. But how come the lyrics, like lyrically, did those lyrics, like those feelings translate into songs?
In a strange way, it's almost like the whole, like, laughing on the outside, crying on the inside kind of thing, so.
Yeah, he's the sad clown.
The clown, yes, exactly. Makeup.
He had, inner turmoil that maybe people didn't really realize that he was. Was he overcompensating or who knows? Like, just being, so out there, but inside he was kind of sad.
You gotta do it extreme,
personality.
Know what I mean?
So, it's just his personality. Only Theater of Pain was
autobiographical.
Yeah, autobiographical, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I went to Upland, and I remember Roz's grandmother lived right at Upland High School down the street. And I remember his grandmother, I think, lived right across the street in apartments. And people always said, oh, that's Roz Williams' grandmother, and she's a witch. You know, like a real witch. Like, she would practice witchcraft. Is that, I mean, do you know
anything
about
that? I don't
know
about it.
His mom was actually like a hardcore Baptist Bibles, like the mom of, what's her name, Carrie, you know, in the movie. Mm-hmm. His mom was like the aunt, basically.
So is that probably explains maybe the pullback on him, or like...
Oh, yeah, well...
Yeah, the rebellion.
Yeah, it's...
Both his parents were extremely religious, but... Not necessarily. If you say you're Christian, then you would be following those Christian values, perhaps. But I don't want to speak about his family, but there were other things going on in his family. And so, like he said, it was autobiographical. He couldn't understand how, if you're supposed to be following the Christian word, how these things could be happening within a home. So
yeah, being raised in like a Christian religious kind of upbringing, and then going, you know, rebellious, and then going, you know, to the darkest pits of hell with the music and with, you know, other things and stuff, which we won't get into, and then at the very end coming out with his conclusion to it all, the summarization, which is kind of, you know, take it as you will or whatever and stuff, but basically, the end part, the prayer, I mean, that's, to me, it always reminded me of, like, his journey out of here. You know, so it was autobiographical in a past, present, and future tense. That's what I got out of it.
Yeah, it seems like a really deep, thoughtful person.
Yeah, he was.
I remember, you know, when Christian Death was around, just the name was shocking, especially back then. It still kind of is, and I really didn't, like, what is this band all about? Was it just to piss people off? But it didn't seem like it was. It seems like it was really something more about Roz's family and maybe like a middle finger to his... What was it? Tell me.
The origin of it is very funny.
Well, what Roz told me was that he was hanging around. He had some real interesting friends, all experimental people like himself. And they're having a laugh, hanging around. And somebody was wearing a Christian Dior t-shirt, and it had the initial CD on it. And so somebody said, oh, what does that stand for? And then somebody else said, Christian Death.
And so, that simple.
Yeah.
That's not a commentary. It's just like, that's simple.
And that's perfect. It's really perfect. It's perfect if you knew Roz.
That goes back to his humor, kind of.
Exactly. Yeah.
I loved all the Hoopla College, you know, especially in Orange County where I'm from, you know, with that, like, what was it called? Melody Land or whatever stuff. They had a big old thing there with Jerry Falwell, was like, you know, saying that I wrote, like, songs of demons and stuff like that, that we're just, you know, we've just pushed the limit and all this stuff. And they had record burnings, and some of my friends went there with their families because they were, you know, Catholic or whatever. Baptist or whatever, and but then when they start throwing records, and their Christian Death records and all these other records, they start jumping in there and pulling them. That was genius.
Yeah.
Back on Christian Death, we just saw you play Thursday, Only Theater of Pain. Tell me more about that. Tell the people more what it is, what's the reason behind it, of having this band.
Well, a friend of ours named Killjoe came up with this idea because of a Christian Death, as time went on, became so, like, away from the Only Theater of Pain kind of sound and everything and stuff, not discrediting it, you know, I mean, there's really good material there too, but it's almost like a tribute band, you know. He goes, we're going to tribute the Only Theater of Pain days, would you like to join them all? Be in my own tribute band?
That's what's weird thing about it. Is it a tribute band or is it not? I mean, well, thinking about it, because you're in it gives it instant credibility. It's more than a tribute band. I don't know. It's weird. It was really cool. You guys pulled it off.
I like funning people like that.
Yeah, it was very, very cool.
Thing, you know?
It's great to hear Rikk play, actually.
Oh.
Nobody can play it like he does.
No. No, that's 100% true. Rikk Agnew, man, you're one of the most, I've always said that. This guy, I hate you because you're so talented. And that kind of leads me into questions with you. Usually people like you that can just literally play almost every instrument have, did you ever play piano?
I do.
Was that your first?
No.
Oh, because normally people like you said, I knew piano as a kid. And because of that, you can play pretty much anything else.
I'm wrong. Always been able to pick up an instrument and play it. You know, that's it.
And that's not only true for you. This is genetics. Your family, your DNA. You know, I mean, it's just a weird... I can't explain it. You probably can't either. How long have you been playing for? And what was the first instrument that you picked up?
Drums, wasn't it? Drums?
Well, when I was a little kid, I used to, you know, try to play the Beatles songs. I had a little toy kit. Then I've always, like, you know, when everybody else was into the rock and roll guitar thing mm-hmm. and stuff like that, I mean, with Hendrix aside, because he's my higher power, he's my hero. Oh, yeah, Hendrix is like my god, basically. I have contacts with him and everything, basically. I know that sounds crazy, but it's true.
No.
And, but at the same time, during the early 70s, I was very much into, like, you know, keyboards. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like you can have your guitar rock gods, you know, and stuff like that. I like the keyboards.
I do too.
You know, Rikk, I like the Keith Emerson especially, yeah. You know, and all that kind of stuff, progressive stuff. Mm-hmm. You know? So
I love when bands use keyboard in a subtle way, not mm-hmm. overpowering, but it just really adds, you know, a lot to it. Besides playing music, you're also a great songwriter too. I mean, Rikk is responsible for so many songs, I'm sure most of you already know, or if you heard them, that's the guy that wrote them. You know, from D.I., from the Detours, from the Adolescents, the list goes on and on and on. And you're still playing music, you know, 40 years almost, and punk music for that long, and your new record kicks ass. I really like the vocals from you.
Oh, thank you.
It was very cool. When I'm listening to it, I'm like, who's that? You know, because I didn't like really, I just put the record on.
Yeah.
And like, oh, it sounds like this person. It sounds like this person. I look at him, oh, that's Gitane. That's fucking awesome. You know, yeah. A lot of aggression and it is really powerful. But
thank you.
That record's very, very cool. I like it as much, if not better than All By Myself.
I don't write songs. I've never written a song. They're gifts.
Well, accept the gift, yeah. And I think...
of sin, the gift of...
I think the songs... And getting back to the Adolescents, I know you're sick of these questions, I'm sure.
No.
That's probably the, if I had to pick a record, I've probably told many of you guys, if I had to pick, gun to my head, the best punk record is the first Adolescents record. And I know George, if he's here, yeah, he agrees too. And it's such a cool thing when people come into the store, regardless of age, you know, there are certain records that we can never have enough of. Adolescents is definitely one of those records. Good music is forever. And I know a lot of those songs you wrote with Casey. You guys are such a phenomenal team. And that also went into DI, you know, which I'm a huge DI fan too. You guys working together, what's the story with Casey?
We did way more acid than the rest of the band. That's why we came up with those songs. And stuff,
you were a couple years older, like them, Tony,
yes,
and stuff. But
yeah.
How'd you guys meet?
Because I'm 58.
Yeah, tell the group about the Detours. The first kind of inception.
The Detours,
right?
Was the first punk band. It was in 77, and they still don't have a record out.
But they did like Hangton and East Berlin. They're on a compilation, KNAC, which was a heavy metal station. And KNAC released this compilation with the Detours on it and other bands as well. The Detours were on that doing a couple. He's taking a dump. That's fine. I want him out of here. He kept farting. Rick was farting.
Oh,
bad.
No, he wasn't.
Yeah, he was. He was not. He just like,
he's
to
it.
He's going to pee in your sink.
No. I'm being on here. Is there a reason?
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
He's in there. Just don't let him out.
He's going to scratch my pole, does he?
Well, I'm trying to train him to do that. Do you have a pole? Let's talk about you, because I know that you're from L.A.
But yeah.
Do you mind if I sit next to you?
No.
So you're originally from here, right? Were you born in California?
Yes, I was born in California.
And then what
year? I moved to Los Angeles around between 79 and 80. And I started doing doing music. I was in a real weirdo art punk band called mm-hmm. Pompeii 99.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. That and stuff goes for a lot of money whenever those records come in.
Oh.
It never shows up.
We got together with Roz, Pompeii 99 did, when he came to our record release party. And Valor and he had a long chat. He was, when Roz came in, it looked like a silent film star coming in. He was all furs and sunglasses and everything. So that's what happened. They met, and then the original Christian Death started to go different ways. Mm-hmm. Roz wanted to have a different band and a different sound. And then
when did you leave? You moved to Europe, right? For a while?
Well, what happened was Christian Death went on a European tour.
Mm-hmm.
Roz. This is 1984. I was pregnant. I had my son on tour, recorded an album, everything. We toured. The band came back to the U.S. Then in 85, we went back to, we recorded Catastrophe Ballet and Ashes with Roz. He quit the band. We went back under a different name band, because he had quit suddenly right when there was a whole tour book.
Mm.
So we went back calling ourselves Sin and Sacrifice, which the promoters were, some of them put down and some of them didn't. And then we were basically over there.
How did the fans receive you?
It was kind of embarrassing, because some of them didn't even know Valor wasn't Roz. They didn't know, and it was very odd. It was very odd to work without Roz. But I ended up staying over in Europe with my son. I had a daughter also, and I ended up having a very lengthy and good solo career,
mm-hmm.
doing different music than Christian Death.
Completely different?
Completely different. It was more like jazz punk.
Yes.
A trio. I like to explore different areas of music. Every album I've done has been different. And Roz came over and
when he left, you guys were still friends? Or
were friends, but then...
Not a cool thing to quit before
then,
a tour.
No, it wasn't. But I understood. He didn't want the name Christian Death used after he left, but that happened anyway later on.
Mm-hmm.
It happened later on with the higher administration of the band, we'll put it that way.
But without any originals, right? To continue on?
Without any original members. Yeah,
just
exactly.
The name only.
Yeah, yeah. So that continued. I left the band in 89, started my own thing. And then Roz got back together with me after I left the band,
mm-hmm.
came over to Europe. We started working together again. We put out an album called Dream Home Heartache. I don't know if you've ever heard of that.
No, I haven't.
No, it's an EP. It's very, very, very beautiful.
It's a 7-inch or a 12-inch EP?
No, it came out on CD on XXX and dark vinyl. And then there was a limited issue on vinyl.
Okay.
So it's real different. It started a new trend or new genre called, noir? Something.
Oh,
Cabaret
Noir.
Noir.
Uh-huh.
So we started that, and we toured together. I came back to LA in 96, and I've just been doing different projects of my own and other things.
Both of you are just, you're music people.
Yeah.
And you're an artist, and the reason I think that like people like this are artists is because you would still be doing exactly what you're doing, whether anyone saw or listened,
if
a million people saw or listened. It's like you have to do it, right? Am I making up something, or is that true?
No, it's totally true.
That's what an artist is.
The numbers don't matter.
Exactly.
You know? They do, but they don't, you know what I mean?
Right.
It's not why, but it's for.
Everything just seems to, no matter if it's big or small, we get taken care of. We take care of ourselves.
Things work out in the end.
We keep doing it. We keep doing it. We'll spend all our money on recording if we have to, but we'll do that. And see what happens later.
That leads me up into the next question with the new record, Learn. The production kicks ass, man.
That's
that record.
Paul Rossler and Rikk.
Oh, Paul from the Screamers, yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds phenomenal.
And my daughter.
Oh, cool. This, you know, like listening to it and the lyrics, what's the theme of this record?
Because
some of the songs seem pissed off, like, you know, you're saying something.
Just getting pissed off about, you know, everybody whining, complaining, crying, you know, drama, this, that, you know, and everything. It's like, you know, don't sit there and just, you know, get a ball of fucking negativity. Just, you know, try to learn from it, you know, own whatever it is, even if it's in the wrong place at the wrong time. You had no intention of, you know, screwing up. Well, I was there at the wrong place, wrong time. Learn. Learn something from it, and it's never a waste.
That's yeah, all, I agree with that. Yeah, everything is learning, or it has the potential to have a learning experience, no matter what happens, good or bad. You guys are back on Frontier. Frontier is a record that the label, Lisa, that put out the first Adolescence record.
Yeah, and Christian Death.
And Christian Death.
Suicidal Tendencies.
Yeah, so many,
so, well.
So many big records have been on Frontier, so you have a good relation with...
Yeah,
with Lisa.
With definitely. Oh, yeah. All through thick and thin. Even when everybody gave up on me, you know, during my heyday, you know, seeing how many drugs and drinking I could do without killing myself, and she still was there for me if I needed money in advance because I wasn't doing nothing. I was broke, you know. Mm-hmm. She would always advance me. She'd always be there to try to help me. There was very few people like that, you know. So
yeah. A lot of people abandon you, right? Because they don't know how to handle it.
Right, and I don't blame them.
No,
I own that. You know what I mean? But it was nice to have somebody there that always kind of believed you, because it, you know, I could go back to her and I could trust her.
What did she say? There are like five top people, most talented people that she believes in, and you're right there in that top five.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you are. Well, that was one of my questions, and I'm glad you brought it up. How has like music helped or hindered you with drug use or relationships? I mean, there's got to be good and bad, right? I mean, how do you, because you look awesome right now, but I've seen you not look good. You know, like I was worried about this guy. Like, he's not going to be here.
Before.
I know it. And that was the word on the street. And now everyone's like, Rikk is back, you know? So, but how do you use music, or do you at all, to reinforce, or is it a demon, or just is it both?
It's both.
It's what I do. That's why, you know, that's what I do. That's what I'm supposed to do here, you know? And to be able to spend all the time doing it, to be able to survive on it, is all I look for, you know, on that side of the spectrum. On the other side, it's to make people happy, to influence them, to give them ideas, to pass it on, you know, pay it forward, and all that kind of stuff, you know, that kind of thing. When somebody comes up to me at a gig, it says, you know, you changed my life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, look.
Well, you know what? I mean,
it gets me all fucking emoed out.
No, I remember the first time I heard the Adolescence record. I was just, you know, I don't know how old I was. I wasn't that old. And we were at my friend's house in Upland. And we're hanging out at the bad guy, you know, like the, because he smokes pot. And I walk into this room, and he's smoking pot. It's probably the first time I ever heard it. And he's like, I got this new record, puts on the Adolescence. And the way I described listening to the Adolescence, it was so mesmerizing, but it had this undercurrent of evil. That's the way I feel, like, in the sense that I shouldn't be listening to this. You know what I mean? Like, there's something wrong about, because I was thinking the way, no, but in a good way.
That's funny.
It's like, it opened up a whole new door, you know? Like, man, this is fucking awesome, because I was coming from listening to, like, what, Blondie or Pat Benatar, which I still love all those bands, but the Adolescents, like, this is punk rock, what the fuck is this? And it was a life, one of those life-changing moments in that.
You could almost see the PMRC sticker on it, and they didn't even invent it yet.
Exactly. It would have been there if they had it at that time, without a doubt. And that record, every single song is just, man, it's great. And I even like the second one, the Brass and Battalion. That's a great record, too. But nothing compares to the first one, in my opinion, and probably most people's opinion. I'm sure people would love to see a reunion with the original, but that'll never happen, right? I'm sure a band's like a relationship, I'm assuming, you know, you get along, you don't get along.
Oh, I get along great with the other guys, but they're not in a million years or for $1 million would I ever do it with them again.
Why?
There's a lot of reasons that I also would not like to bring up.
No, don't.
Having to do where, well, basically, you know, just, never mind, it sounds like a whiner.
No, I get it. I mean, it sounds like you
don't talk about it.
Yeah, if you don't want to talk about it, then don't talk about it. Yeah.
Because you move on. Move forward.
Yeah.
You know, that's why I always looked at it, you know. I don't sit there and try to, why did you kick me out? Why did you just, you know, don't think for justification. You don't want to be where you're not wanted, mm-hmm. So you move on.
Yeah. And you know, you're doing your own thing. Yeah. Hey, you're here, Dr. Strange, and they're not. And you got a bunch of people behind us that love you guys,
yes,
too. So that's a good thing. And like we just said, things happen for a reason. They all work out,
yeah,
in the end. And, you know,
yeah,
it's... I want to get back, because I know Nico is here somewhere. I can sense his presence. I still want to mention that we have a book. And
oh,
I
yeah,
forgot to grab... we have some really cool posters as well.
Can you show the poster?
Yes, look at the poster. That's from John Miner. If you guys want to buy one, they'll sign that for you. The legendary John Miner. I have plenty of posters for you guys.
You read my mind. Oh,
yeah.
What?
It's a really cool...
It's upside down.
Edward Culver photo that he took many years ago. Were you at that photo shoot? Do you guys know this photo?
Rikk would have been playing that show,
yeah,
I believe.
That was at Cafe de Grand.
What year is this?
It was while we were recording the Omni Theater Pain record.
Ah.
And we actually walked our equipment down, you know, because it was only two blocks away. We had like a little death row caravan going along, you know, pushing our equipment and stuff. And that was that, you know, he did the Little Red Riding Hood look, as I call it, because he had like a red, you know, how do you describe it, huh?
What?
The red hood thing, like that he wore during
cowl?
That show.
Yeah,
oh,
like
a cowl.
Yeah, it looked like that. And then he had that cross made out of rose, you know, with the real thorns. And towards the end when we were doing dogs, it's like there's this one huge skinhead guy that was just like, I think he was in love with Ross, but he couldn't let his macho hood, you know, get, so he's just all like, you know, getting in his face and everything and stuff. And Ross just, you know, Ross was nutty, man. He'd just go right in the guy's face. And he's just, oh, see you in hell. And he took that thing and was just scratching it across his face, just like tearing the face open with the thorns. And the guy's just like, okay.
Yeah, kind of wigged him out.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of wigging people out, what kind of reactions did the band get or you get, not only at the shows, but just like in public? I mean, people had to like, what the hell is that?
I joined,
right?
I love joining that band because, you know, they had opened for an adolescent show in PAL Boxing Gym.
Oh.
And when we saw what they were doing, I was just like, oh my God, this is great. Never expected it. That's when I met Ross that night. I just thought, this is really good, but like, you know, we could use more because it was like, you know, stripped down.
Mm-hmm.
And adolescents were headlining. And I got their numbers. 2 weeks later, I got kicked out of the band for the first out of four times. I called them and I said, like, yo, let's do it, because I was so bitter about it. I go, I'm going to, you know, we're going to make this band everything that punks would hate or everybody would hate, you know what I mean? Long hair instead of short hair, you know, instead of acting all, rah, 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 we're going to act totally like Faye and stuff and, you know, dress like girls and this and that, whatever, makeup, you know, play slow and, you know, then... Instead of like pissing everybody off, like basically wanted to, start a whole new subculture. Can't do anything right.
So I'm assuming you're the reason they got signed to Frontier.
Basically.
Yeah. You're the one that.
I don't want to take credit because
seems like an obvious,
you know,
thing. You're friends with Lisa, and you already had the Adolescents record out, and she likes you as a person and knows how good you are, and probably at least gave the band a listen, and you know, yeah, I would take credit. Right. So what's going on? When is the Rikk Agnew band playing? You have so many freaking bands.
Yeah.
Which
is a good thing.
I don't know. We have GDQ.
And
we have a GDQ show, which is Rikk, Paul Rossler, Deb Benham, and myself.
Mm-hmm.
That's a new project. Well, it's actually been around a couple of years, and we have an album out. It's just coming out.
For those who
Germany.
Don't know, Paul Rossler was a 45 Grave, Screamers, Twisted Roots, etc., etc., etc. Nina Hagen. Okay, I'm sorry, go ahead.
And we're doing that at Release the Bats on February 24th. That's in Long Beach.
Release the Bats,
yeah.
February 24th.
Yeah, yeah. And then we're doing a benefit for the homeless, GDQR.
Oh, that's good.
I'm not sure. And Rikk Agnew Band is going to play the benefit too. And so is GDQ and Herbert. And Joe Baeza from Saccharine Trust is going to be doing a solo thing there too as well. And then we'll have one more band. We have a lot of shows coming up. I'm not sure exactly Rikk Agnew shows, though, because you keep track of that.
Yeah, I think that's the first one coming up.
Is it?
Yeah, and then the night before that is...
we just did a bunch of dates.
...is the Doll Hut.
Oh, the Doll Hut.
Well, but with I also played the Deadbeats.
Oh, right on.
So,
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
And they have a new album.
I know they do.
Yeah.
Yes.
666-1313.
Yeah, we gotta get those. Yeah, that's cool. The Dollhead's a really cool place. It's a legendary place, which is about this size. It's very tiny, but it's that'll be a great place to see any band, especially you guys.
It's fun.
Yeah, that's the
yeah, it's
for.
Fun.
Cool. Anything else? Oh, what about how do they get in touch? Website? Anything? Instagram? You know, a lot of people are watching this. There's a lot of fans.
Facebook, probably, huh?
Yeah.
Facebook and emails
Email.
My websites are all messed up right now.
My email is kirkwagen, KIRKWAGEN, @gmail.com. It's a scramble of something. And also...
we always look at our messages on Facebook.
I sell artwork, books that I write, all that kind of stuff, shirts, you know, like the whole bit. I have a store, basically.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's on Big Cartel. And you just go to www.rickagnewshit.bigcartel.com.
Cool.
Two Ks.
If you guys have questions, just get in touch with us. We'll send you to the right direction. Support these guys. Support Nico. They're very cool people, and I really appreciate you guys driving all the way out here.
All right.
And super strange fun day. I think that's it. Is that it? All right.
Oh, wait. You're supposed to bonk us on the head.
I might be.
No!
Thank you. And thank you guys, too, for hanging out. That's very, very cool. Get the book. Get the poster. Get the records. They have like a billion of them, and they're all kick-ass. And check them out.
Thank you, Bill.
Whenever they play. Cool. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Been long and prosper.
Yeah. Hey, I am the Star Trek guy.
Really? You don't know how to say fuck you in Vulcan?
No, I do now. Did you know they're making a new Star Trek series?